You probably wash your hands several times a day. At least we hope you do. These days, hand washing is common practice for everything from food preparation to performing surgery. It's crucial in the field of medicine. It's standard practice today. But in the 19th century, pre-exam hand washing wasn't common among doctors at all. Today, we're talking about one 19th century doctor's doomed attempt to convince his peers to wash their hands. But before we get started, be sure to subscribe to the Weird History Channel. And let us know in the comments below what other historical medical topics you would like to hear about. Okay, let's see those keyboard fingers. Ooh, nasty. You need this video. After earning his medical degree in 1844, Dr. Ignaz Semmelweis specialized in obstetrics, the branch of medical science overseeing childbirth. 2 years later, Semmelweis became assistant to Professor Johann Klein at the first obstetrics clinic of the Vienna General Hospital. In his new role, Semmelweis examined patients before Klein made his rounds. He also taught students, performed administrative duties, and supervised difficult deliveries. He was sort of the chief resident of his hospital at the time, and it wasn't long before Semmelweis noticed a troubling pattern at the Vienna General Hospital: high maternal mortality rates. There were two birthing wards at his hospital, the midwife ward and the physician ward. At the time, midwives were starting to be replaced by doctors in most birthing rooms. Their advanced training and techniques were supposed to be an improvement over traditional midwives. But Semmelweis noticed higher mortality rates among women who had physician-assisted births than those assisted by midwives. The physician ward's maternal death rates climbed as high as 18% and never fell below 13%. On the other hand, mortality rates remained around 2% in the midwife ward. Semmelweis wondered why the old-fashioned midwives saved more lives despite the fancy new techniques the doctors employed. He launched an investigation into why physician-assisted childbirths resulted in more deaths and was startled by what he found. A 19th-century hospital wasn't such a great place to give birth. The primary cause of the high mortality rate in maternity wards was a disease known as puerperal fever. Better known as childbed fever, the disease caused abdominal pain, fever, and delirium. Some expectant mothers took to calling it the doctor's plague. Patients would often lie on their back, appearing listless. Other symptoms included labored breathing, a white tongue, and a pulse as high as 140 beats per minute. Nausea and vomiting weren't uncommon. But worst of all, puerperal fever was often fatal. In her 2005 paper for the journal Medical History, accomplished British nursing professor Christine Hallett described it as a great derangement of the vascular system, with as many as 80% of affected women perishing from the disease. Semmelweis did what every good scientist would do during his investigation into the high mortality rates. He began collecting data. After a few years, the data supported his suspicion. Physician-assisted births led to higher mortality rates. And the same thing was happening in other hospitals in America and Europe. Women were 20 times more likely to die while giving birth in a hospital, while home births typically resulted in a less than 1% mortality rate. It may seem strange to think about now, but doctors often began their day working in the autopsy room. After working there barehanded, doctors went straight to the maternity ward. And on the way, they did not stop to wash their hands. Semmelweis thought exposing pregnant women to cadaverous matter was the cause of these puerperal fever infections. His assessment was dead on. Midwives never did autopsies, but both doctors and medical students did them regularly. The evidence implied physicians might have been responsible for spreading the disease. Semmelweis eventually concluded as much. Doctors played a crucial role in causing the infection. So, he decided to test his theory by instituting a hand-washing procedure in the maternity ward. In the late 1840s, Semmelweis put his theory to the test. He asked physicians and students to wash their hands before performing autopsies and regular exams. The doctors used a chloride lime solution to clean their hands. It was a strong disinfectant, created from treating slaked lime with chlorine. The 19th century equivalent of using a powerful bleach soap, its base components are still used in laundry detergents and bleach today. With a new hygienic practice in place, the test saw immediate positive results. Semmelweis's hand-washing protocol worked. The death rate plummeted to 2%, closer to the mortality rates in the midwife ward. If the thought of doctors not washing their hands makes you squeamish, imagine if they didn't disinfect their instruments after using them. This was a likely scenario in 19th century hospitals. Many physicians didn't accept the germ theory of disease at the time. Bloody aprons and frocks were signs of experience among surgeons. There was simply no concept of germs or the role poor hygiene practices played in spreading infection. Author and medical historian Lindsay Fitzharris told The Atlantic in 2017, "Doctors never wash their instruments or their hands. The operating tables themselves were rarely washed down. These places became a sort of slow-moving execution for the patient because they would develop these post-operative infections that would kill them, sometimes within days, sometimes within months." But it wasn't all used aprons and rampant infections after Semmelweis got involved. After his hand-washing regimen significantly reduced the mortality rate, Semmelweis had doctors wash their medical instruments too. Doing so dropped the mortality rate to 1% and made his hospital one of the safest in Europe. While he did prove the mortality rate dropped as soon as doctors began washing their hands regularly, it didn't exactly sit well with other medical professionals. Semmelweis met opposition when he brought his findings to a superior, the dirty, dirty Professor Klein. Washing one's hands, Klein reasoned, had nothing to do with spreading infection. Klein believed the mortality problem was related to a new ventilation system at the hospital. But why would he believe that? One might say the idea was a lot of hot air. Like many doctors of the time, Klein subscribed to the miasma theory of disease, in which people believed foul odors or bad air. Miasma, as we've covered in other videos, were the primary causes of disease. This theory saw wide acceptance until Louis Pasteur demonstrated the existence of disease-spreading germs. Joseph Lister followed in Pasteur's footsteps, developing the idea to sterilize surgical instruments and use carbolic acid as an antiseptic for surgery. After that, the germ theory took hold, and miasma went out the window. But in Semmelweis's time, doctors rejected the idea they might be responsible for spreading disease. Before long, Semmelweis met with a clear opposition to his ideas from other doctors as well. On May 15, 1850, he gave a speech to the Vienna Medical Society detailing his findings. Many physicians resisted the idea and searched for alternate explanations that would account for his data. This physician with the highest authority at the time, Rudolf Virchow of Germany, rejected the study entirely, remarking in his papers, "Explorers of nature recognize no bugbears other than individuals who speculate." Some doctors didn't like the idea because they felt Semmelweis was insinuating they were dirty or of lower class. Others didn't like the idea that midwives might be better than doctors, completely upending Victorian social and gender norms. One American obstetrician, Charles Meigs, openly mocked Semmelweis, saying, "Doctors are gentlemen, and a gentleman's hands are clean." Many physicians were offended by his findings and refused to wash their hands. Some even tried to sabotage his hand-washing regimen. Even in the face of overwhelming empirical evidence, the medical community summarily dismissed his findings. Semmelweis put his career on the line and provided concrete proof that washing hands and sanitizing tools decreased maternal mortality rates. But Victorian doctors were having none of it. Washing their hands between every patient was simply too much work. Hospitals would need to be rebuilt and redesigned. But there were other reasons too. Maybe it's because he waited 14 years to publish his findings. Perhaps it's because his peers felt insulted. Or maybe he simply wasn't as established as other doctors of the time, so they dismissed his vital research. Whatever the reason, his plea to get physicians to wash their hands fell on deaf ears. It didn't help that he had quality data, but didn't fully understand germs. His peers demanded to know how a post-mortem could harm other patients. His critics pushed him to explain how and why, but he struggled to respond in a meaningful way. Instead, Semmelweis went on the offensive, attacking his critics at every opportunity. He wrote scolding letters to other obstetricians. One brief note read, "You, Herr Professor, have been a partner in this mass demise of patients." Another letter addressed the sabotage of his hand-washing protocols. Semmelweis wrote, "Should you, Herr Hofrath, without having disproved my doctrine, continue to train your pupils against it, I declare before God and the world that you are a murderer. And the history of childbed fever would not be unjust to you if it memorialized you as a medical Nero. It's fair to say he's a little more than angry. Although things would change significantly only a decade or so later, Semmelweis faced heavy criticism for his ideas, but continued to believe in his cause for the rest of his life. All of this took a toll on Semmelweis, and his rage spun out of control. He eventually angered many physicians, resulting in the loss of his job at Vienna General Hospital. Afterward, he returned to his native Hungary to promote handwashing. In 1861, he finally published his studies and proposed his handwashing method to save women's lives. Of course, he also publicly named and attacked each of his critics at the same time. His work would ultimately lay the foundation for modern hygiene, despite its toll and the lack of recognition. Semmelweis later wrote in his 1861 book, "Everything was in question. Everything seems inexplicable. Everything was doubtful. Only a large number of deaths was an unquestionable reality. It made me so miserable that life seemed so worthless." After enduring the scorn and rejection of his colleagues, Semmelweis's behavior became erratic. He became depressed and started drinking heavily. In 1865, possibly suffering from Alzheimer's, Semmelweis was committed to a mental institution. While there, he was treated by being placed in a straitjacket, doused with cold water, and given castor oil as a laxative. When he realized where he was and tried to leave, he was beaten by guards. Semmelweis had been there for only 2 weeks when he died from a gangrenous infection on his right hand, a wound that may have been caused by the beating. The entire medical landscape changed by the late 1800s. Louis Pasteur, Joseph Lister, and other germ theory pioneers provided evidence of germs and how they spread infection. Suddenly, the missing piece of the Semmelweis puzzle fell into place. It became clear that physicians were spreading bacteria from post-mortem bodies to their living patients. Sadly, the theory didn't take hold until after Semmelweis's tragic ending. With the theory firmly established, hand washing became the norm. Dismissed during his era, Semmelweis continues to hold an important place in medical history. Often celebrated for his contribution to modern hygiene, he wasn't the first doctor to suggest hand washing to stop the spread of infection, but he is undoubtedly one of the most important. The story of Ignaz Semmelweis still teaches a valuable lesson. Rejecting scientific results because of unfounded social concerns may end up killing patients in the long run. Semmelweis is now known as a pioneer of antiseptic policy, with several universities and medical institutes bearing his name. There was even a Hungarian postage stamp honoring him a century after his death. But the strangest thing bearing his name is a phrase. The Semmelweis reflex is a phrase that labels a person's tendency to reject new evidence or new knowledge because it contradicts established norms or beliefs. His work and dedication to saving lives through basic hygiene will live on forever. How about we all go wash our hands as a tribute? So what do you think? Did you remember to wash your hands today? Let us know in the comments below. And while you're at it, check out some of these other videos from our weird history.